His name is Peter Whittle. Before coming to Taiwan in 1980s, he was a barrister in London. Since 1990s, for the next three decades, he had been a translator, writer, editor, instructor, consultant, etc. for Taiwan's central and local governments.
There have been substantially great improvements in the English environment in Taiwan. As for the English proficiency of the population, I can't really say that I've seen any substantial improvement over the last 30 odd years since I first arrived. But certainly in the use of English by government, in the provision of English in the environment, and in the provision of certain English frontline services by government, there have been great improvements. A lot of that is due to the work of the Research Development and Evaluation Commission, formerly, mm-hmm. The RDEC, which merged with the Council for Economic Planning and Development to become today's National Development Council.
Right.
In the past, they were involved in a lot of projects to promote English proficiency and to improve the English environment. And they're the ones responsible for the committee that I currently sit on. Well, one shouldn't focus too much on the term bilingual. What really matters is enhancing the English friendliness or the English proficiency in Taiwan. Forget about the words bilingual. What matters is that Taiwan is able to compete with the world, and Taiwanese are able to compete with the world. And in our today's globalized world, it's very, very important to be able to communicate effectively in English. It's very, very important for Taiwan's industries and enterprises. Taiwan's economy is obviously an export-driven economy,
indeed. A
high-tech manufacturing export economy. And for Taiwanese enterprises that wish to go global, that wish to expand into markets outside Taiwan and to establish a presence outside Taiwan, it's absolutely vitally important that they have personnel who are not only able to communicate comfortably and fluently in English, but also they're able to communicate cross-culturally. Mm-hmm. They're comfortable, they have a global mindset, and they're comfortable interacting with people in other countries, which is an important aspect of the bilingual policy. I should say that the bilingual policy, as it's called, has two key aspects. One aspect is to raise the proficiency of Taiwanese people, particularly young people, to make them more competitive and in order that they can contribute to making Taiwan's enterprises and industries more competitive. The other aspect is to create a more English-friendly environment, a bilingual environment in Taiwan. Now that has two key aspects. One aspect is obviously the more English there is in the environment, then the easier it is for Taiwanese to have opportunities to use English in daily life,
right.
And to enhance their English. Because to really develop English proficiency, you need to be living in an environment where you're actually getting opportunities to use,
right.
You're seeing, hearing, and absorbing English in daily life.
Yeah.
But also, very, very important for Taiwan to be attracting foreigners to Taiwan. Four distinct categories of foreigners need to be catered to by providing a more English-friendly environment. Obviously, there are the business people who come to Taiwan to invest, come to Taiwan to procure Taiwan's manufactured goods, come to Taiwan to negotiate business deals, etc. The business people come to attend exhibitions, trade exhibitions, trade fairs. And then the second ones are the foreign professionals. Now, as we know, Taiwan is suffering from a shrinking workforce with very severe shortages at all levels of the workforce. And the National Development Council's projections for manpower supply and demand up to the year 2030, through the next 7 years, indicate that Taiwan will have a shortage of 400,000 key workers by the year 2030. There are already severe shortages at all levels of the economy, but especially in high levels, in high-tech industries, in all service industries. Taiwan, obviously, with its falling birth rate, is one of the world's lowest birth rates. Year by year, there are fewer and fewer people entering the workforce, fewer and fewer young people entering university and then graduating or leaving school and moving into the workforce. Now, of course, Taiwan also is suffering from a serious brain drain, partly as a result of China trying to lure away a lot of Taiwan's best talent from high-tech industries like the semiconductor industry, from the universities, professors. And the OECD a few years ago assessed Taiwan as having the most serious brain drain of all developed economies. And that is, so the combination of the shrinking supply of local people into the workforce plus the brain drain presents a very serious threat to Taiwan's future development and Taiwan's competitiveness. And one of the key ways in which they can address this problem is by attracting foreign talent. And that's why the National Development Council drafted the Act for the Recruitment and Employment of Foreign Professionals back in 2017. And it was substantially amended a year and a half ago, the year before last, to make Taiwan much more attractive, much easier for foreign talent to come and live and work in Taiwan. Foreign professionals, obviously all university graduates, at least with university degrees, people to do white collar work. But previously, prior to the passage of the Foreign Professionals Act, in short, there were only about 32,000 foreign professionals, white collar workers, working in Taiwan, a tiny number, less than a tenth of the number working, for example, in Singapore. Since the Act was passed, the number has risen fairly substantially. The latest figure I had, it was coming up close to 50,000. But the National Development Council is setting its sights on, set the target of doubling that number to 100,000 by 2030. This is very, very important because these people are crucially needed in all areas of Taiwan's industry and also in academia and in the cultural and creative industries, etc. Bilingual schools. Now, of course, they're extremely popular with parents, and as soon as a school announces that it is bilingual, then it becomes an absolute magnet for parents to try to get their children into the school. Absolutely. Now, I live in Linkou, and I've got a daughter who is...
Oh, that's the hub.
Yeah, well, we moved to Linkou about 13 years ago when my daughter was a baby. And there was a newly built school, it opened just after we moved there, and it called itself a bilingual school. Linkou is an area where there's a lot of construction, a lot of building. It's the fastest developing place in Taiwan. The population has surged, and a lot of families with small children have moved out of Taipei to Linkou. So we actually have a hugely growing population of children, the only place in Taiwan. There were a lot of developments, a lot of high-rise buildings, a lot of residential buildings built within the school district of this new school. And the advertising material of the construction companies all emphasized their main selling point was, you'll be within the school district of this bilingual school. On the basis of this, they were able to increase the prices of their property to a much higher level than similar residential buildings which were not within that school district. And this just shows how much typical Taiwanese parents value the possibility of being able to send their children to a bilingual school. And in fact, that school was only bilingual in name, as we discovered after it had opened, and we knew my daughter, we weren't in that district, so my daughter didn't go to that school, but we have many friends whose children went there. Basically, there was no more English being taught in that school, and the way that English was taught was in no way different from other elementary schools. So in fact, it was largely misrepresenting itself. But subsequently, when other schools began to call themselves bilingual in Taipei, in New Taipei, and elsewhere in Taiwan, and began to better understand the requirements, then they were able to offer a little bit more than that school. English has been emphasized in Taiwan's education system, but the way in which it's been taught has been totally flawed, deeply flawed, because it's been taught as an academic subject, which involves memorizing rules of grammar, memorizing lists of vocabulary, memorizing sentence patterns, perhaps, and then regurgitating them in exams in order to pass exams. So it's totally exam-oriented. This is no way to learn a foreign language, to absorb a foreign language in a way that you're able to use it in real life. So one of the key points of the bilingual policy is obviously the introduction of bilingual education, bilingual schools, in which English will actually be used as a tool for learning, so that students, not just learning it as an academic subject, they're acquiring it as a tool that they will be using in their school life. And it's also very important, that's another reason why it's so important to create a more English rich environment, as we can say, so that they also have opportunities to use the language and to, outside the classroom. So it's not just something that they're learning at school in the way that they learn maths and other subjects. And as far as the impact on native languages is concerned, and those who raise objections saying that learning English will squeeze out other languages. Now, when a government or a Ministry of Education, education authorities decide upon priorities in children's education on the language side, they have to consider what is most valuable to the students and what is most valuable to the country, to the nation. Now, obviously, everybody must prioritize the national language, the language of the common language of all the people, which is Mandarin Chinese, the language by which all Taiwanese can communicate with each other. Mm-hmm. Now, the second most important priority has to be the language of international communication, since Taiwan's relationship with the world is of the absolute highest importance. Mm-hmm. So the language of international communication, the international language, which is English, the unchallenged lingua franca of the world, obviously has to be given second priority. Now, you can also, there's absolutely no reason why children shouldn't also be learning what I would call their heritage language, whether that be Hakka, whether that be Hoklo, Taiwanese, whether it be an indigenous language, one of the many indigenous languages, or whether it be a so-called new immigrant language, such as Vietnamese, the language of perhaps the mother, or in most cases the mother who has married a Taiwanese and become a citizen here. Right. Now, those languages, the appropriate place for learning those is within the home and within the community. Now, it's very nice if the schools can also make some provision for children to attend classes in those languages, but that has to be a third priority, because the benefit to the individual of learning those languages is less than the benefit from learning the national language, Mandarin Chinese, and the international language, English. And the benefit to Taiwan as a nation from people learning those languages is lower than the benefits from learning Chinese, Mandarin Chinese, and English. Now, also, I feel that you cannot dictate to people or ordain that people should learn their heritage language. A lot of people are not interested in learning a heritage language. They're totally satisfied with being able to speak, to use their the national language, the main language of the nation, and the language that will give them international mobility and that will give them the best career development opportunities, that will open up the best prospects for them in life, which is, of course, English. But for those who do care, or for the parents of children who do care about their children learning their heritage language, then provided the government is ensuring that they do have opportunities to learn those languages, then I think that's sufficiently catered for. Now, looking at the support that the government is giving to English versus the support it's giving to these heritage languages or native languages, there's the budget for the bilingual policy for English, basically, is initially, when the policy was introduced, there was actually no special budget provided, which disappointed me enormously, because the government was basically asking existing departments of government and local governments to find
can't do anything.
The funding from their already very stretched and tight resources. But fortunately, a budget of 10 billion NT dollars was subsequently allocated from the budget for the forward-looking infrastructure development program to cover 2021 to 2024. But because this raised certain opposition from certain quarters of society, Su Zhengcheng, when he was premier, he then allocated a budget of three times as much, 30 billion NT dollars, to support these heritage languages. Now, the key thing about promoting language acquisition is what I have an acronym for it called MORE. You have to give the people more. Now, the M of the MORE stands for motivation. Mm. You have to give them a reason to want to learn the language. You have to make it relevant to their daily lives. You have to make them see how they will benefit from learning this language. Then you have to give them opportunity. You have to give them the chance to be able to attend classes or to find resources. You have to make resources available so that they have the opportunity, the best possible opportunity to learn that language. And then you have to give them either recognition or reward, the R of the MORE. Recognition means some kind of certification of your achievements in that language. Reward means that there's some tangible reward for achieving some kind of progress. For example, that could be giving it a higher weighting in applications to the civil service, which is part of what the bilingual policy is doing. It's giving, there's a plan to give increased weighting to English in exams for admission to the civil service and for promotion within the civil service. Also for university entry, it has to be given higher weighting. You can also give higher weighting to heritage languages, Taiwanese, which would also some easily accessible and cheap and effective means of certifying people's achievement in a language. And this is also one aspect of the bilingual policy. It aims to make provision for people to obtain certification, not the current expensive paths of TOEFL and all of the other international English exam systems, which are very expensive and not convenient or easy to access. And then the last one is the E of MORE is enjoyment. You have to make language acquisition fun, enjoyable. If you're to become involved in international society, actively involved in international cooperation, international initiatives, for example, the international initiatives to respond to the COVID pandemic and to global warming and so forth, then you need to be able to communicate in the international language, the global lingua franca, which is English. Obviously, language is an isolating factor. If your language is a language not spoken elsewhere, then you're isolated from people elsewhere. And few people outside Taiwan, except in mainland China, are going to be learning Mandarin Chinese. And very, 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 very few, except for overseas Chinese, are going to be learning Taiwanese. For Taiwanese people, if they're speaking on behalf of this country and expressing, I mean, if they're trying to explain to people outside Taiwan what Taiwan has achieved, what Taiwan's merits are, why Taiwan is worthy of great admiration and respect, which it is, then obviously they're going to reach a very limited audience if they use Chinese, because the whole audience, I mean, the vast Mandarin-speaking audience is almost entirely in China, and they're totally deaf to whatever message is coming out of Taiwan because they're totally brainwashed, etc. So they need to be able to communicate in English as the international language. Now, of course, there's a great lack of the necessary proficiency in English among Taiwanese people to be able to go on social media and to be able to speak up for Taiwan if somebody from the mainland is peddling the usual story about Taiwan belonging to China, etc., and peddling anti-Taiwanese propaganda, peddling stories about the divisions within Taiwan and misgovernment, and then of course they need people who are able to articulately counter that and speak up for Taiwan and tell whoever is interacting with them on these international social media the reality of the situation. At the moment, there are very few Taiwanese who are able to do so. So it's necessary to cultivate the ability among Taiwanese to be able to uh, to be able to express these things, discuss these things. And Taiwan has a great deal to be proud of, most of all its democratization, what it's achieved in the last especially quarter of a century. I mean, originally when I first joined the government, we were telling the world about Taiwan's economic miracle, the right. amazing success. But now it's the democratic miracle, as you might call it, that Taiwan has all the greater reason to be proud of, because it's pretty well unprecedented. And Taiwan is now, you could say, a model democratic nation, not just within Asia, but globally. The National Development Council drafted an organic act, an act for the establishment of a bilingual policy. It was called the Bilingual Nation Development Center originally. And this was approved by the Executive UN and was submitted to the Legislative UN about a year and a half ago, best part of a couple of years ago. This is a very, very important institution. It's very important to set this up, because this will be the entity responsible for promoting and coordinating the implementation of the bilingual policy, bringing together public and private sector resources, and also helping to promote cooperation with English-speaking countries. There are many, many aspects which this center will have a very important role in playing. It's essential that it has some central, focused, dedicated entity which is conducting all of these projects. At the moment, the bilingual policy, there are a lot of disparate elements, different groups, different organizations which are carrying out projects, but not coordinated.
Peter, thank you very much.
My pleasure.